Grazie. Buon pomeriggio.
Good afternoon. I would like to open this session. We have two very important guests. The Mediterranean is the story of a love that is immortal and dramatic at the same time. It is a privileged space of human life, of its story, of the encounter and the conflict, the war. More recently, in 1991, the world seemed to enter a new phase. A beautiful book was published in Italy, Mediterranean, a prayer book by a Croatian writer. It talked about the bread, the wine, the trade, the kippa, the crosses, the half crescent. So a beautiful world it was depicted in this book. We, people of the Mediterranean, would have been able to regain that horizon. Soon after that, the Balkan War broke out with the dissolution of Yugoslavia, and once again, love was destroyed. After that, the Iraqi War and all the events we all know. The Arab revolutions, the Arab Spring a few years ago, were observed with astonishment and hope by all of us as a new beginning. And then the Muslim Brotherhood, ISIS, and all the events of this terrible moment. Today, we cannot look at the Mediterranean as it was depicted in that book. It looks more like a somber enigma, full of drama, full of difficulties, where horror kills hopes every day. And the only bridges of the Mediterranean today seem to be the boats sinking, the bodies, the corpses of the refugees in the, at the bottom of the sea. But we are part of this Mediterranean family, and we do not want to give up. We believe that this love is still an important vocation. And from the point of view of the meeting that has always celebrated the friendship among the people of these shores, these seas, well, today we are here to talk about the Mediterranean again, to say that we are going to follow our mission. We want to build on love. We do not want it to be a promise that has not been kept. So I would like to welcome the Minister Taieb, Baccouche, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Tunisia, and the Italian Foreign Minister Paolo Gentiloni. And I'd like to voice the feelings of the Rimini meeting, to really thank the minister for his friendship and to thank him for his help and his support with the efforts of his diplomats and his ministry. We really managed to have very important guests here in these days. So I would really like to thank the minister for this. I know we have here ambassadors and diplomats from the ministry. I'd like to thank them all. Tunisia was the first country to have an Arab Spring and is now paying a very high price to save its democracy, its openness, its freedom. So I would like to say, Mr. Minister, that we want to be close to you all, to your country, and we're here to listen to you and to share your pain, your suffering, and your courage. Thank you. Thank you again for being here. Minister Baccouche is the foreign minister of the Tunisian government since last January. His story is the history, the story of an intellectual, of a scholar. We spoke about this yesterday. He is a scholar. He has studied literature and linguistics. And yesterday we talked about Chomsky, and who is a very important figure in the world of linguistics. And tomorrow we will listen to his words here at the meeting. So his whole life, the minister's life, has been devoted to education, universities, schools. He has devoted many, many years of his life to this kind of work. He worked as a journalist, and he has also been chairman of the Arab Institute for Human Rights. I'd also like to remind you that he is also the secretary general of the party Nidas Tunis. From the day of its foundation. You have the world, Mr. Minister. Thanks again for being here. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers of this important event for this opportunity to meet in this beautiful city, the city of Rimini, and for the warm welcome they gave us on our arrival. I'd like to thank Roberto Fontolan for his very nice words of introduction. It's a great joy for me to be here with you, dear friend Paolo Gentiloni, to take part in this meeting and give my contribution in the debate on the theme starting from the Mediterranean, a new horizon for international politics. I believe this theme, this topic, has been carefully chosen, and it is even more important and decisive in the light of the turmoils and the events that are taking place in this region from the beginning of this century, which became even more serious with the Middle East conflict that threatens the safety of the Mediterranean. Ladies and gentlemen, the commitment of Tunisia towards the Mediterranean has never faltered. It has strengthened gradually year after year, also because of our country's determination in making the Mediterranean basin a real region of cooperation and brotherhood among people. So our country has carried out actions for stability and prosperity, and has created a real policy for the Mediterranean. The ultimate purpose of this policy is the creation in this area of a solidarity partnership aimed at common development that can strengthen peace and prosperity on both shores of the Mediterranean. It is important for the southern and northern shore of the Mediterranean to favor the strengthening of cooperation among people in order to meet all the challenges we are facing. I am convinced of the importance of the role that can be played within the European Union by countries like Italy to reinforce cooperation in Southern Europe, a cooperation that has to take into account all the legitimate and interests of the northern shore of the Mediterranean, such as energy, safety and immigration, and at the same time takes into account the challenges of the southern countries of the Mediterranean: job creation, education, training, fight against desertification, management of water resources and environmental protection. Ladies and gentlemen, the action of Tunisia in the Mediterranean is carried out through the existing cooperation structures. At regional level, for instance, Tunisia participates in the 5+5 dialogue, which since the Rome Declaration on October 10, 1990, is the meeting point of the 10 countries of the Mediterranean. My country is chairing the sectorial meeting this year in the field of defense. During the meeting in Lisboa with the foreign ministers of the 5+5 dialogue last May, we have offered to host the meeting of the summit of the ministers of cultures next October. Tunisia has always defended the Euro-Mediterranean space inaugurated in Barcelona in 1995, as well as in the framework of the Union from the Mediterranean in July 2008 at the Paris summit. At the heart of the Mediterranean, Tunisia and Italy in over 3,000 years were always strategical actors in this region of civilization. And today they are working together so that the Euro-Mediterranean region can be the center of the neighborhood policy of the European Union. Ladies and gentlemen, apart from the formal or informal cooperation framework in the Mediterranean region, this region has always been, as has also been at the beginning of the millennium, the place where geopolitical changes took place. The Tunisian people fought for their dignity and their freedom together with the peoples of this area. The transition from authoritarian systems to democracy is still possible today, and it is necessary. It is encouraging, but is also endangered and needs to be supported. It calls for strong will and solidarity. Thanks to this democratic transition, this encouraging transition, we have a new change in the Mediterranean that has actually influenced all the Mediterranean countries, thus strengthening the idea of a universal democratic right and the right to freedom. Therefore, what happens in Tunisia, dear friends, needs your solidarity, your active support, especially in this situation where the country has to meet a lot of difficult challenges, both in the field of safety and defense and in the social and economic field. Tunisia is now, at the moment, living one of the most difficult chapters of its contemporary history of this democratic process, which is strategic because from its success or failure, we will determine the future of the geostrategical and political situation of the southern shore of the Mediterranean. This situation gives Tunisia an important role and imposes Tunisia to succeed in its democratic experience in order to be a model for other countries of the region and to guarantee prosperity and stability at the Mediterranean gate of Europe. Tunisia has put an effort that is complete to this goal. Terroristic attacks will not change this. On the contrary, they will strengthen our determination to go on and to meet this historical challenge, because we wanted to show the world that the southern shore of the Mediterranean is not against modernity and democracy.
À cette occasion, je souhaite renouveler mes remerciements.
So I'd like to take the opportunity to personally thank and to thank on behalf of the Tunisian government for the support offered given by Italy to this democratic process in Tunisia. Rome has always been during our revolution, during the transition phase, has always been ready to support our democracy, which is now starting to take shape, and help us meeting the challenges linked, connected to this transition. Ladies and gentlemen, the Middle East conflicts that become more and more urgent and interwoven touch upon our common space, and they are a cause for instability at global level. In the whole world, they have a destabilizing effect, as we see from the terroristic attacks. There is a feeling of injustice, and there is a rejection of people's identity. Terrorists do not believe in universal values, and they can be used to reject diversity between cultures. Well, we speak often about the clash of civilizations in the 21st century, just like the 19th century was characterized by nationalities and the 20th century by ideology. A clash that is a clash between extremists and radicals. And it is a passionate and violent clash, because it is a clash of cultures at different level, including the religious level. This concept feeds on the lack of confidence, on the fears we have, and it must be rejected, because if we accept this concept, we fall into the trap of terrorism, who want to put men against men, cultures against cultures, religions against religions. So we need to counter this concept with a different political, cultural, and moral culture based on respect, on the exchange, on dialogue among all the cultures and religions that are connected and that are dependent on human values, those values that make us what we are today. Universal encompasses what is specific and goes beyond what is specific. All these responses and answers have to echo in the Mediterranean as well as in the rest of the world. The Mediterranean needs to acknowledge these values and participate in this fight in favor of dialogue and tolerance against extremism and integralism. We should not forget that the Mediterranean space in the past was the melting pot of so many different peoples, nations, cultures. It was really the melting pot and the cradle of monotheistic religions, source of human dignity and freedom. There was a time when our cultures were really interconnected. Averroes used to follow Aristotle, who was, according to him, the person sent by God to state the truth. Saint Thomas Aquinas saw in this genius of the Arab science the best critic of the Greek and Latin heritage. Subsequently, our stories took a different course. Then today we have to be united in front of this emergency. We need to forget our fears and go beyond the things that tear us apart and build a joint future. This is a fundamental fight for the Mediterranean that has to draw on its essence to remind the world of the importance of openness and dialogue, thanks to its history and its geographical location. Our common sea, as Camus used to define it, should make us appreciate this mix of cultures, and it has to go back to be a contact point connecting men and spaces. Ladies and gentlemen, the Mediterranean has become the central point of incomprehension among peoples. So it has to keep its promise of a universe where everyone feels safe and strong enough to accept differences. Your meeting this year is an opportunity to find new answers, to express our ideas. And I'm really happy to have brought the voice of Tunisia here at the meeting. I would like to wish the organizers and the participants every success in this 36th Rimini meeting. And I hope that it will contribute to strengthen the values of fraternity and solidarity among all the peoples of the planet, and particularly those of the Mediterranean, particularly young people. Thank you for your attention.
Grazie, signor Ministro. Ora.
Thank you, Minister. Now I give the floor to Minister Paolo Gentiloni, who is Member of Parliament elected in Rome. He was member of the Foreign Affairs Committee and also the Interparliamentary Union. He has been in politics for many years, and also he worked as a journalist. He was elected in 2001. He was president of the Surveillance Committee for the Rai Television Channel and the Communication Service Committee in the Prodi government. And at that time, he already came here, so it's not the first time you are here. But anyway, we are very happy to welcome you back to this event and in this event. which is really important for us. Thank you so much. Thank you. I would like myself to thank the meeting for this great opportunity of having a dialogue on the Mediterranean, and also for designing this session together with my colleague Baccouche, whom I would like to welcome as a man who represents what is for us a country that is a symbol of courage and hope. This is Tunisia today. Thank you, because on the part of the meeting, this is not a recent discovery. This subject has been at the top of the agenda for more than 30 years at the meeting. In 1987, Father Giussani organized a meeting of the Mediterranean that was held in Greece. And I know that immigration and Mediterranean culture has, and the Christian persecutions of Christians and interreligious dialogues have always been topical at the meeting. And thank you, because we're doing this today. Today, where the challenge of a new order in the Mediterranean is perhaps strategic for Italy's foreign policy and also for Europe, that's probably the most critical area. We, as Italian government, have been working in this period to put the Mediterranean back at the center of the global agenda. And it was not easy. We must admit this. There are some sources from the last centuries that go across more easily in the international community. For example, the discourse on external threats, or the discourse on Ukrainian eastern regions, as if we had 1938 references, or the Cold War discourse. All these dimensions and challenges are certainly important for us. However, we might have focused for too long on these external threats. Another threat that is sort of internal, that it is within our region, and that it is peculiar, it's not it doesn't consist of one country attacking another country. There's dynamics under our society, behind our societies, is now developing. And Italy, within the EU context and NATO and the G7, has always worked a lot to involve in Bavaria, for example, to involve the Tunisian minister and or the prime minister there, and he then took place, he was involved. So what is going to happen in this region is really decisive for the future of the world. The meeting this year has a wonderful theme by Mario Luzi. I don't want to read it again, because I don't want really to misread it, but it's really beautiful. I would like here to read another verse by Eugenio Montale, Italian poet, dedicated to the Mediterranean. "Ancient sea," Montale said, "remembering its dangerous law, being vast and diverse and at the same time fixed, vast and diverse. And the Romans used to call it Mare Nostrum. For the Jews, it was the Great Sea. And the Middle Sea, the Middle Mare for the Germans, the White Sea for the Turkish, the Big Green for the ancient Egyptians." You see how many names are attributed to the Mediterranean Sea, which mirror its extraordinary variety. But it's also a fixed sea, in the sense that there is no way out of one's destiny and one's geography. Sometimes in debates in Italian politics, I hear comments by people who seem to think that it is really possible to run away from our geography and our history, but it's not possible at all. We are there, we have miles of coast, and we must find solutions for a dialogue and for peace. This Mediterranean Sea has been undergoing a crisis for years now, not months, for years, that due to religious, social, demographic, and national reasons. Some people dare to compare this with the war of the 30 years in the 17th century in Europe with conflicts among Christians. I'm not sure this comparison is acceptable, or if we are going to have a Westphalia of the Mediterranean, Eius Regio, Eius Religio, then might solve this problem. For sure, I know that, as my colleague Taieb said, we must avoid the clash of civilizations and even worse, of religions. And the only way to avoid this clash is to fight against fundamentalism and terrorism and defend the vast majority of Muslim communities and the presence of Christians in the Mediterranean and in the Middle East. That's the way to avoid the clash of civilization and the conflict between religions. And I believe we have to work in this sense in order to build a new order of the Mediterranean. And there are some main points that should be addressed. First, safety and security linked to terrorism. Over the many years of instability within the crisis of the Mediterranean, I believe that the West perceived the limitations of constant actions without future, that is, military actions that maybe were based on good purposes and were the response to emergencies, but with no prospects for the future, from Iraq to Libya, for example. For this reason, because these dynamics are in crisis, the Mediterranean has become a sort of center of diffidence for the West. Now this diffidence is really manifested in the Mediterranean. There is a reluctance there. The Romans used to call it Mare Nostrum, and we don't want the Mare Nostrum to become a Mare Nullius, that is, a place that is abandoned to itself, where the forces working for a world order do not really take on the responsibility to build this new order. And we, Italians and Europeans, must take part in this work. We must play our part, being aware of the fact that it is now no possible to be just users of a security that was offered by somebody else. We sort of lulled in this sense here. What does Italy do? Well, we use the security created by others. And maybe even criticizing the subjects that were offering such a security. Well, we may consider the past, but if we want to look at the future, we know that Italy has to play its part in building this order that is very strategic world at a world level. And we must do it fighting against the terrorism, for sure, in particularly the challenge of Daesh, which is the ISIS, which is the most dramatic one, working to create peace, to establish peace in difficult contexts such as Libya and Syria. And then we must consider the historical conflict of the Middle East, supporting some key states. The consolidation and of development of these states is fundamental for the area. Tunisia, first of all, I would add Lebanon. That's another key country that is threatened today by serious migrant phenomena. And then a pluralist decision-making system is also needed there that must be supported. And we must do this defending the presence of Christian people. That's a small flock with a big responsibility, as our Holy Father defined them in a letter to the Christians in the East. But this is important not just because we are Italians and it's our cultural root, but because the presence of Christians is an element that cannot be eliminated from the cultural and the pluralist nature of the Mediterranean and of the Western world. Without that part, well, the picture would have been distorted completely. The second item, the second point, concerns migration. This is really is a general issue today, affecting everybody. And it's also disturbing sometimes, because when we see TV news and we see those the consequences on the political and social level, well, we understand that it's a really big problem. I think that we share similar ideas in this respect. We all know some basic things that everybody should know. First of all, that this problem must be tackled and solved through the whole route where it is present, since its very origin up to the very end. Migration does not just start on the Tripoli's shores or in Bodrum in Turkey. It starts much earlier in Africa, in conflict zones, in other places, in contexts where there's hunger and war in many parts of the world. I also believe that we may agree on another point, which I really consider important and really makes me feel almost uncomfortable. What's the destiny of Europe? Maybe one of the biggest utopias for us in the West, or for us in Italy, that we had over the last 10 years, that is the utopia of the United Europe, of the United States of Europe. That's one of the founding myths of the Italian Republic. Today, many people talk about the destiny of Europe and the need for Europe to be relaunched in a way. In this respect, I want to make a very easy point, very simple point. And I make this point with great respect towards those who are involved in this area. I do not think that relaunching Europe may take place within the laboratories, the workshops of institutions, through red tapes, through documents on the new architecture of the Union, etc. Well, this dimension is certainly important within the debate. It must be developed. We have to be part of that, and we have to play a role as Italians. However, now Europe is regaining its role, considering the most important political issues in the world. And that's why I want to restate that one of these is migration. It is on migration that Europe must find its identity again. Otherwise, the risk is of losing this identity forever. We can't really accept to keep seeing the images that we see today with all the turmoils and fights that are rising everywhere. Institutions, the EU institutions try to find solutions. The agenda of the Commission, for example, there was an interview to President Juncker today, which expressed really interesting things in a positive direction. However, all these really became weaker within the institutional dynamics. So we learned that we are the most powerful commercial subject in the world. We are a place of civilizations and funding elements for the rest of the world. And sometimes it seems that we are not able to solve problems at the border, at our border, with problems affecting just a few hundreds of people. Well, these situations are not acceptable because of the history and the dignity of our continent. And here I believe that we must take action on a European level to have a common effort to review the Dublin's precepts and to share at the European level this challenge. And then the other level concerns the fight, but in a civil way, with dialogue, with debates, with culture, to fight against those who perpetrate hatred and illusion and fear within our country. With these people, Italy cannot go anywhere. And I think that in this respect, we must create credible policies and not to follow this or that sudden success or fame, as has been said by somebody who is much more distinguished by me. So we really need to defeat fundamentalism and terrorism. We need to deal with the phenomenon of migration, which is a long-lasting phenomenon, and trying to be organized and to solve it in an organized and civil way. But we also need a serious need for development, economic development and growth, new job opportunities. Minister Baccouche said this before. Surely, Tunisia is an extraordinary example for us. I said before that's hope and courage. The courage of preserving a pluralist setup with a pluralist government, pluralist media, and a rich and articulated society before a threat to its security and safety, which is a really dramatic threat. But the government and the people and the parliament in Tunisia didn't give up. They might have. Say, well, we really can't deal with it, we can't keep up with this challenge, but they did. They took very courageous measures, for example, closing up illegal mosques, and they managed to give an extraordinary example to the whole region. After this, they received a lot of congratulations from Europe, from the West. For example, every time that we meet, well, we stop dreaming because they tell us, Italian friends, European friends, Western friends, we are grateful for your nice words, because of what you say about Tunisia now, but we need to work together to build job opportunities and development for young generations and an economic future for the country. And this is relevant not just to Tunisia, but it's relevant to the whole region, for many countries in the Mediterranean area. It's an opportunity for us too. I am sorry that I couldn't accomplish one thing as a Minister of Foreign Affairs, and that thing is providing the idea of the fact that the Mediterranean is all the things that I have mentioned. So it can be security, there is a crisis, there's migration, but that the Mediterranean is also an extraordinary opportunity for economic development. It is an extraordinary opportunity for companies and for the job market in Italy. It is not just a threat. Let's put together all the countries in this region. Well, we discover that they are fundamental countries. I think of Tunisia, but not just Tunisia. They are fundamental to act as a bridge towards Africa. For my generation, this country has been a lost continent, a continent with no development, a continent that was abandoned in hunger and illness. But we know, in fact, that it is now at a turning point. There is economic and development factors for men, for women, for civil society's empowerment. And on the other hand, there is terrible crisis with conflicts, with terrorism. So the Mediterranean is a bridge towards Africa. And overall, this area has growth rates that are really interesting for our economies. They stand at around 3-4%, and Africa stands at about 4-5%. And it is a group of countries in which Italy is one of the fundamental economic and political parties and trade parties. Maybe not everybody knows that Italy is the fourth trade partner in this area, after the United States, China, and Germany. So we are talking about an area that represents a great opportunity for the future for us, and not just a threat for our safety and security and for living together. I think that we should insist on this, working on this to create the conditions dealing with the issues of safety, security, and migration of an order within the context of the Mediterranean region, offering potential for economic and human development. We must set this potential free, and I think this is a wonderful challenge. It is a challenge that Italy, its government, the civil society, the NGOs, and all the voluntary associations must be involved, and they can give a big contribution. Thank you very much.
Grazie.
Thank you. We still have a few minutes at our disposal, so I'd like to ask a question to Minister Baccouche. He said that the desire for freedom is universal. Well, I think this is actually the force that has driven the young Tunisians in on the street to protest, just like it did with young Egyptians that helped them fight for days and days. So I'd like to ask Minister Baccouche, how do young people live today? How do they feel in this particular moment when our democracy is in a way threatened in its reinforcement, strengthening? What's the hope for young Tunisians? This is a very important question, actually. It is true that the Tunisian revolution was driven by young people. that it didn't have any political or religious overstructure. It wasn't a completely spontaneous act. It was the result of a series of injustices and frustration that led to this. The young people who protested and created this revolution hoped to achieve their goals very quickly. And well, now they are disillusioned because no one had foreseen a series of transitional governments that didn't last a year. Five governments, one after the other, and that couldn't really carry out any strategic action. They could only guarantee the transition of the state and the daily management of state affairs. Only after recent elections, we went back to, well, so to speak, a normal situation. Nevertheless, there's a gap. On the one hand, we have what we have achieved in terms of democracy, of politics. On the other, we are lagging behind in trying to achieve our social and economic objectives. This is a paradoxical situation that has been made even more serious by terrorism. So young people in Tunisia are very impatient. They wanted to see the results of their revolution, especially at social and economic level. They want safety. They want certainty, employment, job, and freedom. So we want to actually overcome this gap between what we have achieved in terms of democracy and the backwardness in achieving our certainty, our social goals and political goals. Tunisia can't do this on its own. It needs, obviously, to count on its own skills and effort, but it needs also the active support of all the people that believe in democracy and in freedom. Our friends, our neighbors, particularly our European friends and Italy, in particular, as my friend Minister Gentiloni said, Italians do believe in this, and we all have to share this idea. Only by carrying on our social and economic reforms with mass investments to create well-being and jobs for young people, well, this is the only way to let young people see their future and let them understand that their revolution is bearing its fruits. So this is the challenge we are now called upon to meet. There are young people who are maybe too impatient sometimes, and well, impatient people normally are attracted by the call of terrorists who offer a lot of money and who brainwash these young people and hide terrorism behind a religious dimension. The worst contradiction ever is this lie. That is to say, to be in favor of terrorism because it is seen as a religion. This is something that we have really to fight against.
Minister Gentiloni
talked about passionately, and this is not the first time he does this, his words were being often reiterated in this difficult period. So he spoke about the topic of Christians. You know that here in Rimini we followed this debate, but well, this is not something that has only to do with Christians. We follow the church and the great school, the great lesson of the church that speaks about people whose fundamental right to freedom of expression, of confession, of faith is regularly violated. And this is something that does not concern only Christians. And then, well, we are really stunned when we see some images. For instance, our cultural heritage. I see Professor Buccellati here sitting in the front row. People that have worked a lot, a long time in Syria, so we really, really know that it is terrible to watch what happens to people, but also to their history, to their monuments. So you talked about a reluctant European. Well, I'd like to ask you to help us understand this concept. Why are we so reluctant? When we look at what happens, we see it with our eyes. We don't even read about it. We really see the images of what is happening. Nevertheless, we are reluctant. We are unable to overcome this reluctance. Or is this a typical institutional and political phenomenon? What do you think?
Ma io cerco di capirne le.
Well, I try first and foremost to understand the reasons behind this. If we want to call it the reluctance of the West, well, this has a specific origin. This comes from the experience of difficulties or even the mistakes over the last 10-20 years. Certainly, this is a surprising contradiction. Well, before, our colleague, Mr. Fontolan, mentioned a couple of points. We may mention more, but we can focus on just these two items. On the one hand, the presence of the Christians and the minorities, religious minorities in general. Or we might talk about a very small religious minority, the Tazidis minority, whose women were persecuted by ISIS. But naturally, the presence of Christians has a historical value and a value of civilization that we all know. And what is going on is really alarming and dangerous because it is difficult to go back. I visited some refugee camps and that were the home of some Christian people of the Ninimes spine. And the most striking thing for me was the difficulty to reconsider the possibility to go back to their homeland. which they had to flee, it's not easy to get back after tragedies and problems like these. And on the other hand, besides Christians and religious minorities persecutions, there is the issue of our historical, cultural, and civilization heritage. We Italians are maybe particularly stricken by this because of our interest in history or in this subject. Well, in many of these countries, we find really interesting things. We have a big interest in archaeological sites, in museums, for example, the extraordinary Bardot Museum in Tunis, or the archaeological museum in Beirut that is being reconstructed by an Italian team, or our 25 archaeological missions in Egypt. We are inside this context, this reality, and that's probably why we are really shocked by the violence that is being perpetrated to it. So there is certainly a gap between the seriousness of these tragic events and the reluctance of the West. This reluctance derived from the fact that one becomes aware of the difficulties showed by the line of action that only envisaged interventions, direct interventions without prospects. And we must say it very clearly, it didn't work. The American administration, and in particular President Obama, are considered now the symbol of this reluctance, the reluctance of the White House we're talking about. Well, I normally say this first, that President Obama said this, that the troops would have been called back from Iraq and Afghanistan if he had won the elections. And second, there is the fact that there's not more than 50, 100 or 150,000 troops. Well, this does not mean that one is going to give up its own role or its leadership. It means that everybody are called upon, and we Italians must be feel called upon on the fact that the guarantee of safety and security must be more and more the result of dialogue and multilateralism. There isn't somebody that can solve the problem on our part, on our behalf. And I think that we must take responsibility for this reluctance, understand the reasons behind it, and propose solutions in the political context, in the multilateralism and a commitment of each country. I don't really like people that provide oversimplified answers towards this reluctance. Let's consider Libya. Over the past weeks and months, we have heard many people saying many times, Italy should play its part. What is this part? Is this a support with any means to the negotiations, or trying to have a major role in guiding the results and the aftermath of reached the negotiation, for sure, or maybe trying to stop terrorist attacks? Well, for sure. However, if this invitation to take action means something different, that is military actions, for example, well, I just think that the Italian government and the Italian military are not going to have missions in the desert, because they're not useful. They would only worsen the situation. That's why we have to come to terms with this reluctance in a mature way, in a complex way. There is no easy answer, and that's the challenge we have to face.
Un'espressione del Papa.
The Pope said something that has become immediately famous. It is a piecemeal third world war. And this is something that has become similarly famous. It has been repeated and repeated. It is as if Pope Francis actually gave voice to something that everyone feels. And well, maybe this is really the case. This is really what is happening. This expression was also repeated by his message to the meeting by the Italian President Mattarella. And this has actually caused some anxiety, some preoccupation. And the President speaks himself of this piecemeal third world war. I don't know whether you have, obviously, a solution to this problem. We can call it a piecemeal third world war or something similar, but it is really a dramatic situation. So this is the question. You are two foreign ministers, and you have a very strong responsibilities, and you have to meet this kind of challenge every day. How do you manage to bear this burden in your daily life? I don't want to be too simple and ask you if you can sleep at night with all your political responsibility, but you have responsibilities before your country, but also before other countries as well. So in such a difficult situation, how do you live with this responsibility? Minister Baccouche. Well, it's not a personal question. We just would like to understand how we can contribute, how we can share this burden with you. Yes, it is true that the situation is particularly difficult and particularly, well, dangerous. We live it, experience it in the same way. I believe that to face these problems and sleep peacefully at night, we need to be determined, but at the same time, we need to base our actions on our ideas and our values. Our diplomacy in Tunisia is based on some principles. For instance, never interfere in internal problems of other countries. This is one of our principles. But do not adopt an attitude of negative neutrality. Do not encourage armed conflicts. This is another principle, because we saw how military intervention, armed conflicts, in Iran, in Iraq, in Syria, in Libya, wherever it happens, just make the problem even more serious. So, when there are problems, we try to find political solutions and peaceful solutions thanks to dialogue and concertation. And this is the will, the concept that guides us in facing the problems of our region, so that we are not left alone, we are not isolated, we work together with our friends, as for instance our Italian friends, and the other countries of the Mediterranean. So this task is a well quite complicated because of some aspects. The Arab countries of the region do not share the same idea, do not share the same approach. Some take one side, the other take another side, and this leads to the long conflicts. If all the countries of northern and southern Mediterranean could adopt a joint approach, that is to say, if they were all convinced to find peaceful solutions through political negotiations, through compromise, well, if all the countries of the Mediterranean did that, the situation would certainly be better. So this is what drives our policies. So, well, I cannot say that I sleep peacefully at night, but I can say that I have nothing to blame myself for.
Ma io, in risposta alla domanda...
Well, to respond to this question, I would like to refer to my anguish on the one hand and on my sleep on the other. Well, my anxiety, my anguish, even if this might seem strange, we are still working. We're still working to make people understand how big is what is at stake. The words from the Pope, from the President of the Italian Republic, follow in this. As I said before, there's discourses that are stronger than this, and they endure when there is reference to piecemeal Third World War or germs of a new world conflict. Well, in parts of our world, people keep thinking of the previous century. We don't really look at what is going on around ourselves and within our societies, in the communities that live in our countries and near our borders. In order to raise this awareness, we still have to work a lot. We're still working on this. So this might make those with government responsibilities feel uncomfortable. We keep thinking about this. And sometimes it is as if we wanted to ask, please stop the world, I want to get off. Or we wanted to think, OK, let us build new walls and put all the migrants in an offshore platform and keep the problems out and away of our country and society. Well, that's not the case. So the first job that we have to keep doing is to be aware and to make the international community aware of how different these new challenges are compared to what we had to face before. It is not an armed conflict between sovereign states. Or, well, that's not the main form. It's the hybrid forms that we are facing that infiltrates our internal realities and with which we have to come to terms in the political, social, cultural terms. And maybe not just on the military level. And there is the dream. When I sleep, I dream. And so the dream is this. I think that we can acknowledge this quite easily, because Italy is the country of dialogue. It is a country that does not have a hidden agenda and that does not want to impose something to the others. Italy has traditionally promoted dialogue among everybody, and the dream is that it can make a contribution to what is really needed. Let's call a Helsinki of the Mediterranean. It would be necessary to provide a structure, to provide a shape to a new pattern of multilateralism that can guarantee living together, dialogue, and safety. It's a very ambitious journey, that's why I call it a dream, but that's a journey in which our country can really play a major role. Thank you so much. I would like to thank our two guests, in particular Minister Baccouche, not just for his remarks, but also for the time that he gave us. And Minister, I would like to tell you to conclude that really in our small, big reality, whatever we can do for your country, for your society, for your young people, we will try to do it. Thank you once again. And to conclude, there is a short video about the meeting, about the fundraising campaign to support the meeting. And with your donation, you can contribute to keep this event living, this thing that we have tried to build even today. There's different areas in the fair center, C1, 1A3, and C5, or the website through which you can help this adventure and challenge of ours. Thank you very much. And you all invited to leave the hall as soon as possible because they need to reconfigure it for the next meeting. Thank you.